Yeah, so welcome everyone. Thank you for joining in. My name is Monica. I think most of us are aware. So every Saturday we meet at 8 o'clock just to, if I can say, center us more deeply within ourselves and hence also understand the world and our own self a little better. Yeah. So I suggest that we'll start with a short meditation, very short. I usually keep it very short, just to kind of get in touch with our own self. And many a times, many of us may have resistance towards the meditation, and that is absolutely normal. It's okay to have resistance towards the meditation. And I feel that why it happens is that mostly we live on the mental level. You know, we are always in the thoughts, feelings, and it is very rare for some of us, maybe already, be in the body. So we are not in the body usually. As if, you know, the body is vacant and we are just everywhere, here and there. So initially we will face a resistance when somebody, those of us who may not be doing or in touch with any kind of meditations, and let yourself go through the resistance. So just know that it's okay to have this resistance. And still you can be here. Yeah, still we will be benefited by each other's sharing and reflections. Yeah, so even with the resistance, we will just follow it in whatever capacity what we can do. And then we will open up the dialogue session. Yeah, so just wherever you are, if possible, I would request that close your eyes. Don't keep them open, because it leads to a lot of distraction, because you will be seeing me speaking and my gestures and all that, and you will, your focus will be on the gestures rather than the voice. Yeah. So I request you all to just close your eyes gently, softly. And just relax your breathing. Relax your breathing. Just keep it very normal. Breathing. No need to engage in tricks and manipulation. Just relax your breathing. Stay with your breath for a few seconds. And now imagine that as if you are going to travel in the body. You're going to touch each and every corner of the body. You are very minute, like an atom. So as you are closing your eyes, you are looking at this blackness within. It's a dark space. Touch each particle of the space. Be one with it. As if it's a well that you are falling into. Stay with that darkness, the space, the empty space. Now go to your toes. Now we are doing this all in the inside space of the body. Touch the inside space of your feet, toes, your whole foot. Touch the inside space of your legs, the dark, empty space. Come up slowly, gradually. Touch the inside space of your knees. Your thighs. The back of your thighs, buttocks. Touch the inside space, yeah, the dark, empty space. Know yourself as that space. Now travel up to waist. Up to the middle of the tummy, solar plexus. A little up, touch the inside space of your chest, the back, the spine. Touch the inside space, underarms. Be one with that space. Your arms, shoulders. Stay within the body, the inside dark, empty space. Arms, your fingers, your palms. Yeah, now travel up again to the shoulders. Go to the back side of your spine. Cover the neck, the inside portion of neck. Come forward. The front side of the neck. All done inside. Now travel up. Touch the inside of your eyes. Your nose, the inner part of your face. Be one with this empty space. Your breath. Yeah. Now travel up to your eyebrows, the top of the head. Yeah, so each and every particle is full of this awareness. Wherever you went, you took this awareness. Now the same awareness, the same empty, seemingly empty, blank awareness, which works in me, works in you, in each one of us. And as if this awareness is like a screen on which the whole drama of our life takes place. All our stories, the thoughts, the feelings. If not for awareness, there can be no drama. So it is this loving space, full of love, which allows everything to happen. It allows resistance to be. It allows all the yes, all the no's, all the imaginations, thoughts, feelings, sensations. And we are this awareness. This is our true nature. And here only we find rest. So whenever you feel ready, you can relax and open your eyes. Take your time, no need to rush, and then we can start the dialogue. So I'll just share a bit about the theme today. The theme today for top discussion, I thought, let's take suffering, you know, because it's something which we all go through in some or the other phase of our life. And one wonders, what is the requirement for suffering? Why is it there? The mental suffering, the emotional suffering. Not considering physical pain here, because we can go through all kinds of pain. It's the suffering that we create for ourselves, and as if we become trapped in that creation. Yeah. And all that we seek through that suffering is rest. Although we don't know how to achieve that rest. So we wonder, okay, whether maybe this relationship will bring me rest. Maybe moving places will bring me rest. Maybe, you know, finding a new partner, new relationship, finding a new job, maybe that will bring me more happiness and rest. And whenever I'm saying rest, it includes this inner joy, inner happiness and fulfillment that we all crave for through all our agendas. You know, even if we are on the spiritual path, and if I ask you today that would you still walk on the spiritual path if spirituality will make you miserable? You would actually have second thoughts about it. Because all that we are craving for is this deep contentment and rest. So even mostly that we come to spirituality is in the search of this deep rest. Otherwise, no one would turn to spirituality, because it seems that it has the answers. And it truly has. It truly has. But often what happens is that even on the spiritual path, the same story keeps on repeating. So I live as a beggar in the ordinary world, so-called practical world. And when I'm on the spiritual path, I still remain a beggar. I continue to be a beggar. Always wanting more fame, more name, more respect, more recognition, everything more. And why would I want more? Because it will make me fulfilled. So all that the root of our seeking is this inner fulfillment. And whenever we enter into these discussions, they make us ponder, wonder upon that although I seek fulfillment, but whatever ways I use, they don't truly give me a lasting fulfillment or lasting rest. So where to find it? You know, we all invest so much in security, safety, comfort, luxury, you know, LIC, you know, this insurance, that insurance, so that we can be safe and secure. But are we ever safe and secure? Can we ever be safe and secure? There is no, the body can never be safe and secure. We may just have an illusion that now I am safe. And it's really amazing that why we crave for that ultimate safety and security, because our true nature is full of safety and security. And as if we all have a little memory of that, not knowingly, we just know that I have to be safe, I have to be secure. But the places where we look for it is a wrong place. You know, Kabir ji says this couplet I often use, Kasturi kundal base mrag dhunde ban mahi, aise ghat ghat ram hai dunia dekhat nahi. So that inner fulfillment that we seek outside, the deer seeks outside, it is here. Now, where? That is the mystery. And it is such an obvious mystery. It's so obvious that we ignore it. That's why our nature, you know, we call that all suffering is because of ignorance. When we ignore our true nature, you know, we are just banging our heads on all the walls and ignoring who we truly are. And that is what we touched upon in the meditation. our true nature is this ever present self-aware awareness, which we also in Vedic texts, Upanishadic texts, we call as Purusha, the witnessing Purusha. It sees and allows all, it sanctions all to happen. It says a yes to all the drama of Prakriti. That is what our nature is, all the emotions, the thought patterns, the beliefs, sense perceptions, that comes in, all these movements come in the nature. Now, our job as human beings, you know, after that, I'll open it for further sharing. Our job as a human being is to know our true nature, really know it, not intellectually, mentally, conceptually, the know our true nature, live, abide by our true nature, live as awareness. What would I say in this context if I know myself as awareness? Would I still be insecure? Would I still act out of insecurity? Would I still act out of fears? Or would I just look at the fear and be with the fear? Because awareness is fearless. And yet it allows the fear to be. Yeah? So the more and more we live as knowingly, practically as awareness, we see that we are able to shed this light on our thoughts, on our actions, on our speech, our behavior, and our life. The whole life has the power to change. While if I continue to live by my stories in the head, you know, what was done to me and what I did to others and all the drama of life, we will continue to suffer. So this is the signal that suffering brings for us. It says, wrong place, wrong place. And the moment you touch even a bit of a story, suffering comes back. It's like a ghost, you know, it never goes away. So you may be having a very happy 2-3 days. The story is okay, you're contented. And the moment you touch the story again, me and my demands and my expectations, mere saath kya hua, mere saath kya hoga, all the anxieties, worries, the moment you touch it, the suffering reappears. And the more we stay in remembrance who we truly are, you see that in that particular moment, suffering cannot be, it's not possible. So if I truly now, on this path, I have suffered enough. We all need to suffer enough. Only then we are convinced that we need to find a way. If I have suffered enough and now I am ready to move, I have to get in touch with my true nature, knowingly. Although I am my true nature all the time, because if I am aware of my story, first comes awareness. Only awareness makes the story possible. Although the true nature is in function throughout, but I am in ignorance. I am ignoring it. In my ignorance, I suffer. In my knowing, suffering is not. Yeah? So with that, I will just put a tape on my mouth because I speak a lot. And I would please request all of you to share why are we here and if you have any reflections or sharing on this matter. Yeah. Any challenges faced on the path? Because there are many challenges on the path which we go through. Yeah. So if there are any doubts, any challenges, it would be nice for all of us to reflect upon it, because your sharing is one with others. We all go through similar issues and it helps when we talk about it. So feel free to share anything.
Hi, Monica.
Hi, Saurabh. Please go.
On the challenges, yes, I can put forth one challenge to this group and seek the inputs. So, say example, somebody is on the evening walk, and another known person to you just ignored you without saying hi to you. Now, it's a very simple situation, but now something inside me is busting into some kind of ego or some kind of challenges to say why somebody is not saying hi to me. Now, I struggle a lot to, even though I know that I am the observer of this thought, but how not to feel the suffering? I mean, indeed, this is some kind of ego inside. I'm do observing my ego playing a role here, but how to get rid of this pain of suffering? You know, how to say the one who is suffering because of someone is not saying hi is not me. I'm just the observer. So beautiful. This is a very challenge, yeah. You know, thought of sharing and seeking inputs from everyone. Yeah.
So, Saurabh, we cannot say that I am just an observer of suffering. No, that's not what it means. If suffering is there, I am misidentifying myself. So one cannot say that, yes, I am suffering, but I am the observer of the suffering. Nah. And it's good that you brought this up. Very good. You know, because in the moment that you enter your head and you have this story going on, why did he not attend me, and you know, all that going on. In that moment, if you check within yourself, you will be seeing that you are identified as the story in the head, but not as the awareness. So owing to this misidentification, suffering reappears. It takes place, it takes birth. So what we have to do, the moment suffering appears, just remind ourselves that we have to anchor ourselves in this, knowingly ourselves as this awareness. Knowingly, it's very important, because unknowingly we are awareness. For awareness, it doesn't matter. Our true nature is our true nature. It doesn't matter for that true nature. What matters is that we suffer. Yeah, because it's like this is my true nature, and I become like this when I'm in the story. It's like constriction of myself. Yeah. And we are not happy here. We are not happy here. So one needs to attend to the suffering. I cannot say I am the observer of suffering. No, bilkul bhi nahi. Because the moment this constriction happens, suffering happens. And by this constriction, I mean that I am now identified again as the ego self, as the separate self. Jisko sense of lack se jo bhara hua hai, the beggar inside me, who always craves for appreciation and attention. The moment I become this, I suffer. And the moment I am here, knowing myself as awareness, suffering is not. So would that address to what you were sharing, or is there something more?
I mean, how part is still not very clear. Suppose if you were the person who were ignored by someone of your known friend, then how will you react in that situation? How will you?
Why do we need to react? आपको करना क्या है? मतलब मैंने चलो आपको बोल दिया, अरे वाह सौरभ, बहुत बढ़िया इंसान हो, बहुत बढ़िया, बहुत बढ़िया. अगली बार मैं आपको मिली और मैंने आपको बिल्कुल इग्नोर मार दिया, एज इफ कि सौरभ डज नॉट एग्जिस्ट. नाउ ये क्या बताता है? ये चीज क्या बता रही है आपको? अपने बारे में क्या बता रही है?
कि I am dependent on others' approval and I'm waiting for validations.
And why do I need validation? Because it makes me feel
that I do exist in society, I do have a value, right?
Exactly, value. I am something.
Right.
Right? And who is saying this, I am something? Because the person, the fictional imaginary character in me, who is full of this sense of lack, जिसको हम ईगो कहते हैं, वो है जो डिमांड करती है अटेंशन, वो है जो डिमांड करती है अप्रूवल. सो हाउ वी लिव इज वी लिव एज अ स्लेव टू दैट फिक्शनल सेल्फ, जो कि एग्जिस्ट नहीं करता. आप अगर उसको ढूंढने जाओ, all that you are going to find is awareness. You will not find it.
Suppose there is an inner dialogue starts to say, hi, I am ignored, for example. So then what happens next? What should be done?
So in that moment, in that very moment, just ask yourself, would awareness say I am ignored?
No.
Or would the fictional character say I am ignored?
That fictional character will
fictional
say.
Character. Yes. Are you that fictional character?
I think I should not be the fictional character, but I am right now.
You are, absolutely, absolutely. Yeah. So what happens is that I am identified with the fictional character. The awareness gets identified, constricted at one point as the fictional character. So just to give it an example so that maybe it makes it clear. Imagine that Anupam Kher goes out to play a role. And he plays the role of a murderer. Yeah. And the story is really filthy. Yeah, it's a sad story. Now he forgets to change his clothes. He's still the murderer. And he's looking at all the fellows. He's walking back home and he's looking at all the fellows and he's feeling like a sinner, you know, all the time feeling like a sinner, really, because he knows what all he has done. Yeah. Now, the moment he reaches home, his wife says, why are you in such a mood? What happened? And he says that, oh my God, you know, see, that person looks at me and that person looks at me and I have done so much today, you know, it's just making me feel miserable. So what the wife does is she reminds, but that was the story. You are not your story. You are much, much more than that. Although when the character was being played, so all there is to the murderer is Anupam Kher. If you, you know, go and find out the murderer. Okay, who is the murderer? Let me find out. All that you will find is, who will you find? Murderer is the fictional character. So when you go find out the identity of the murderer, who will you find, Saurabh?
Anupam Kher.
Anupam Kher.
Right.
So that is what we find when we go investigation in where, what is the origin of this story? All that we find is the Anupam Kher, which is our awareness. And that is what people have called in, you know, non-dual teachings as self-inquiry. You know, Ramana Maharishi, if somebody was asked him a question, he would say, who is asking that question? Go and find out for yourself. And the moment we go digging, if you really reach the root of your question, you will find that all that is arising from the awareness, like ocean gives out waves, awareness gives out these stories, plays, feelings, imaginations, everything. Now, if I have to find deep rest, if I am ready for it, if I really seek fulfillment, pehle uske liye hamein taiyar hona chahiye. You know, if I have not suffered enough, if I feel that I will find a rest in my story, then abhi ye mere liye nahi hai path maybe. But if I have suffered enough and I have tried all the quarters and I have not found fulfillment anywhere, then it is the turn to take an inward turn. And see that all that is there to my story is this fictional self, the murderer. Full of a sense of lack, full of a deep restlessness. Yeah. And hum kya karte hain? We are the slaves of this ego self. We live a whole life as a servant of this ego self. Wo kehta hai, are, I am hungry. You know, I am hungry for more power. So we give him more power. Still no contentment. No, power to aa gayi. I am hungry for more property. So we never question, bloody, why are you hungry all the time? We never question. And if your hunger is not to be satisfied, because I have satisfied it so many times, you still are unfulfilled. I now want to give it rest. So what we keep on doing in our ignoring of our true nature is, we live as if we are the ego self. But if we were, then we will be contented. Because if it is my true nature, I will be contented. But are we? We must ask ourselves, are we contented living as egos? Being a slave to that fictional character? Being a slave to its needs, its desires, its hungry tummy? And so much we do for it. As if bandhua mazdoor kehte hai na jisko. Aur usko hum naam kya dete hai? Ye meri desire hai. And that is where we fool ourselves. We give it the name that this is my desire. And even after a desire is fulfilled, sense of lack persists. Or maybe, I don't know if maybe there are some of us here who would say that my sense of lack is gone after feeding my desire. No one would say that. You get a temporary satisfaction and that is it, gone. The discontent is back again.
And Monika, is it fair to say ki the person who was ignored, chalo, that was a fictional character, which I thought I am. जिसने इग्नोर किया, is that also a fictional character?
No, आपके सामने है वो बंदा, देखो, I am not saying that reality नहीं है बंदे की, real है, आपके सामने चल रहा है.
Right.
But the story, हम जो story बनाते हैं ना दिमाग में, वो हमें परेशान करती है.
देखो, अपने आप बन जाती है, मतलब
बन जाती है, बन जाती है, right. बन जाती है, क्योंकि उसको ऊर्जा कौन दे रहा है? स्टोरी को फ्यूल कौन दे रहा है? द ईगो, या एंड वेयर डज द ईगो गेट्स एनर्जी फ्रॉम?
इज इट डिजायर्स?
यू. द प्लेन आंसर इज यू. Wherever I give energy, I fuel it. If I give energy to my artwork, I am fueling the artwork. If I give energy here in the head, in constructing those cobwebs, I am fueling it. Now it appears a default. Saurabh said that it appears helpless. One feels helpless. I am totally with you. One actually feels helpless. Owing to the fact that it is running from centuries. You know, as if a ball is set rolling. These are our tendencies. The mind is addicted to thinking. And it's hard to break an addiction. You know, if some of you have gone through addictions, I have. And I know that one has to go through a lot of discomfort. Withdrawal symptoms happen. You really have to go through a tadap if you have to leave that addiction. So when we are on this path and we have to leave the addiction of over abusive loop of thoughts, we have to go through some or the other discomfort. And also engage that life energy towards something more purer, more of beauty, which takes you towards the remembrance of your true self. If I continue all my, you know, previous habits, then the addiction is going to stay. So whenever we go for rehabilitation, you know, these addiction centers where people are rehabilitated, they give you a proper schedule of the day. You know, okay, this much of gardening, this much of meditation, because there is so much of bubbling life energy in us. What to do with that? Where to put it? So if I'm not smoking cigarettes, I need to put energy somewhere. So parallelly, we need various engagements. It's not, you cannot imagine that just by sitting all the time, I can take care of this mind. Not possible. Through the body, you have to work. You have to tire yourself at times. Put yourself in such works, such satsangs, or even bodily works, sports, outdoors, nature, which silence the mind. It's a long, long journey for each one of us. And you must also be convinced ki yahan kuch mila nahi. Un stories mein kuch mila nahi. Wo conviction aapki honi chahiye. Agar kuch hai mere mein jo samajhta hai ki abhi milega, yahi milega, to badhiya hai, badho aage. Mil jaye to ho sakta hai some new discovery happens. Abhi tak to nahi mila, wahan. Stories mein no one has found ever a resolution to suffering. There are no happy stories.
I have one question. So
yeah, please.
So in the context of a story, right? If I win, so right now there is a story going on. Let's just say the story lasts for 1 hour. And at the end of this 1 hour, main jeet gaya ki mujhe jo chahiye tha, I got what I wanted. Then the next story can start. And maybe I can try to win that. In this one, I fail. So I go back and think, okay, yaar, mujhe to jeetna pasand hai. I messed up. I lost in this one. Okay, what was the reason? Okay, maybe I was not prepared enough. Maybe I didn't practice enough when I was by myself. Then I go back, I do my practice and I hone my skill, I get better. So वापस अभी जब next time I face the same story, I'm confident कि यार इसमें तो जीत जाऊंगा. So what if I see everything that is following in my life as a series of stories, and what if I have the desire कि यार दूसरा कुछ काम नहीं है, let's just try to win. How would that be viewed in the context of our discussion so far?
Yeah, thank you, Abhishek.
Yeah.
So, Abhishek, jeetne, jeeto, win all your, jeetne ka kuch nahi hai, jeeto. Main jeetna kyon chah raha hun? Most of us want to win because after winning, I feel as if I have become something, which Saurabh was sharing in the beginning. As if myself...
happy.
You feel happy, exactly.
Yeah.
So what you are doing is, you are actually placing the burden of you, your happiness on an external situation. Now, it's okay if you win, but you also get the other side of the coin alongside. The other side of the coin is, if you don't win, you suffer.
But I can go back and prepare, right? To win the same game the next time.
As long as you are ready to be in this rat race, go ahead. And there is no problem with winning and losing. Obviously, there are competitions. We win and lose and then we prepare better. We, perfect ourselves more. Absolutely. The thing is, why am I perfecting myself better? Is it that I like to do that? It gives me joy. It gives me progress. Yeah. Or is it that without that, I feel always this sense of lack and I cannot tolerate that? Now, only for you to ask this question to yourself. What is the intention behind winning?
I think winning, it's as simple as making me happy, right? And that's what Abhi, that's the reality that's in front of me. If I just put myself in a situation, like I've been born in this world and baki ke log hai, there is a trend going on. People are, saying all the things that they're saying. And in my head, I'm like, I'm just observing what other people are doing. I feel ki if I win in the game that these other people have defined, I feel better than them. Because us empty space mein, there is nothing else now.
No. Okay. Let's just pause here. Huh?
Okay.
So if I told you that Abhishek, you are going to win this game, but the moment you win, you are going to suffer extremely. Would you still say, yes, I still want to win?
No.
No. So what are you really wanting?
Happiness.
Happiness. That is clear. So all that we want is not winning and losing. All that we want is happiness. And there is a direct path to happiness. Although you can still go ahead and play the game, win or lose, whatever, yeah? But there is a direct path to happiness where your happiness is not dependent on winning or losing. You win, great, celebrate. You lose, okay, doesn't matter. Next time, even better, yeah? Why the need to talk about this direct path? Okay, what happens when we are so competitive? Have you seen people who are very, very competitive? They are extremely, extremely, as if like, you know, they're idhar hat, you know, baju hat, mujhe aage jaane de. So because their happiness is dependent on winning. So whenever we run in this rat race, we become extremely insensitive, non-compassionate, abuse our own self and abuse others. And is this the world that we want for ourselves? Definitely no. Is this the world that we want for our children? Definitely no. So if I still keep on ignoring my true nature, saying that it's nothing but an empty space, which it is not. It is full of potential. It's full of love, compassion, kindness, strength, courage. This is our true nature. So if I keep on ignoring my true nature, not even having touched it once, and say that I will still run, I would say try, experiment as long as you wish to. Kyunki hota kya hai ki jab tak hum thak kar karke, you know, when we are ourselves not tired of it, we actually don't get convinced. So this conviction is very important for each one of us that yes, I have tried enough and it is not lying there. I have tired myself of running and still I don't have lasting happiness. Yes, happiness comes, but it comes in blinks, right? It comes, goes away. Yeah. So what we are talking of here is that yes, there is a direct path to happiness because all that I want by winning is happiness. All that I want by power is happiness. So I may still have power. But I will not be depending on that power of my or my money or, you know, the chairmanship or everything. My happiness will not be dependent on it. Yeah, so this is the kind of exposition one can put forward that why we all deserve to be happy. We all, it's our birthright to be happy. It's our true nature. And why to get to our true nature by 10,000 distorted ways when there is a direct path? Yeah. Would that make any sense, Abhishek?
Yeah, I'm still reflecting on this, so it'll take some time.
Yeah.
Yes. This connection of what is going on, I feel this is my experience, of course. I need to go through my stories. I'm not convinced. Unless, and what Abhishek was sharing, I have tried, I'm successful. Every time I tried more, I'm successful. I got a success, but still not happy. I see I cannot control others. And sometimes the results are coming. They are not direct result of my efforts also. Sometimes I got results beyond my efforts. Sometimes I not got results though my efforts were full. So, but I have to come back. But and I have to experience it. I cannot miss see all these theories. I got fed up. I'm a bit frustrated, sorry. But I got so much frustrated about the theories. Because this all theories I know very well, but it is not working for me. You say something in inside, I'm not able to touch because my resistance is so much, I refuse to discuss with myself. There is no inner dialogue. It is refusing. And then when it is tired, get tired, then slowly that calmness descends. And it descends automatically. That is my experience. When I tried, no. This is my awareness, my awareness. Awareness is not inside at all. And I get more frustrated, more agitated, and I fight. Of course, with the years, I learned this is the story. So I stopped giving trouble to my people around me, but it gives trouble to me. So that journey also has now trouble to myself has reduced. That timing has reduced. But still, trouble is there. And I feel we need to experience it ourselves. Unless we experience, theories will not work. It has not worked, at least in my case. And it has worked. The realization has come because this suffering, the failures, and the success, this ego were necessary for me to bring this awareness. And the more the suffering, more the ego, more the my fighting, so much was that this success also is coming. And I'm feeling more happy and calmer. Of course, this is something in bouts it comes, but still I have to struggle with. But some realization is there. So what you are talking, I absolutely agree with you. But because now it is a big experience. Some years ago, if you are talking this, I said, no. What is this stuff? This is only stories. It is not happening like this. Today, I experience it. So I said, yes, I agree with you.
Yeah, beautiful, Ashok ji. Yeah, absolutely with you. Actually, again, one cannot say much that unless we truly practically get in touch, through our own practical experience, this happens for us. Rest, everything actually remains just a burden of theory. Absolutely with you. Absolutely. And I think that is why Kabir would say, Pothi pad pad jag mua, pandit bhaya na koe, dhai akhar prem ke padhe so pandit hoye. So that descent of calm and peace that you were talking about, that is the shining forth of our true being. Because the nature of our true being is full of peace, calm, and lightness. So whenever, which Ashokji was sharing, that I tried, nothing happening. Tried, nothing happening. And then you got tired of your efforts. And the moment you got tired and you sat, okay, mere kare to nahi hoga, mujhse nahi hoga.
Yes, correct.
Immediately the shining of your true being shines forth. So this is what we call, in that moment, we experience the surrender of the ego. That mere kare nahi hoga. Yeah. And still we cannot say that we need not put efforts. Because if Ashok ji had not put efforts, how would he realize that my efforts were not working?
Correct.
Yes. So actually his efforts were working because they gave him the realization that the efforts are not working.
Right.
Yeah. So we all need to go through all this, it's full of toil and struggle for each one of us, years and years of struggle, and although it appears so obvious, yet it is full of struggle. And that is the journey that we all undertake as human beings. Yeah. Yeah.
I had one question, if no one else has anything. So when we began the session, right, you asked a question and I didn't get much time to think about it because you continued. You said the question, would you follow spirituality if you knew at the end that it was suffering? So immediately to my mind, the idea came that no, if I knew at the end of something there is suffering, I wouldn't follow it. So if I think of spirituality just like an object, like any other object, and if I think, okay, if I pursue this object, I will suffer. So I don't want to pursue this object. So I will imagine maybe there is something in this world, some object, which upon pursuing that object, there is no suffering. Maybe I'll find happiness. So I'll try to find an answer along that path, or I'll try to find the path which will lead to this special object which doesn't give suffering. Does that mean that if spirituality has suffering at the end of it, should we, why should anyone pursue it? Something like this. I hope you get the...
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So Abhishek, the idea behind asking that question was that in all our endeavors, what we truly seek is not the object of the endeavor, but what will it give me?
The outcome.
The outcome. Yeah. And that is happiness.
Yes.
Yeah. So it was just a pointer for all of us to realize that all we are seeking is not that object of attention. For example, I may be seeking a relationship. Now, maybe I interrogate myself and I ask myself that, okay, what will I get if I have a good relationship? Happiness. What will I get if I have a job that uses my talents and skills and people appreciate me? What will I get? Happiness. So all that I am seeking is happiness. But the thing is, in seeking, I forget, or I maybe in ignorance, I feel that this will give me happiness. This will give me happiness. That is what all our efforts are. Okay, marriage will bring you contentment and happiness. Has anyone's marriage given contentment and happiness? If you ask anyone.
I mean, we can't say for 100%, right?
No, I can say. I can say. Why I can say it? Because in marriage also, there are ups and downs, no? So lasting happiness cannot be got from any external situation. I'm talking of lasting happiness. I'm not saying that people are not happy at times in their marriage. Not regarding that. There will be ups and downs in marriage. If you ask people, maybe if you do a statistical analysis of all the people who are truly married, you know, who have married and stayed with each other, you will actually realize even logically, rationally, that no marriages are happy marriages or throughout. You know, there may be a certain harmony. I'm not saying that harmony is not there. People may be in good frequency with each other. But I can never be dependent on the marriage for my happiness. Because if I do that, I am going to get really abusive. I will say, okay, it's your responsibility to do this and that because it will make me happy. And that is what happens in relationships, expectations and demands from each other. So it more becomes like a business rather than love. You know, it started with love, but it later becomes a business. You give me this, I give you that.
But isn't every transaction with another person a give and take thing? Whether it's
transaction means give and take. Yeah.
So every relationship is a transaction.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying here, because since marriage is a relationship, it is a transaction. Yeah. And that is why we suffer in marriages, mostly. Not all the time, mostly we suffer. It gives us suffering because, again, I'm depending for my happiness on this transaction. Yeah. And that is what we are talking here, that since happiness and contentment is my true nature, shall I continue to ignore and depend on others to give me happiness? Because if I continue to do that, suffering will be there. I cannot avoid suffering. But since we are so egoistic mostly, all of us, that we have this blind rush. Ki nahi, mujhe to karke dekhna, mujhe to kar. So that's what Ashok ji was sharing. Ki kar karke dekh liya. Kar karke bahut dekha. And when you really get tired, daurat daurat daudiya, jahan lagi man ki daud, daud thake man sthir bhaya, to vastu thor ki thor. So Kabir says that I ran in every possible direction. Daurat daurat daudiya, jahan lagi man ki daud. Daud thake, daudne ke baad nahi mil ra. Haan? To thak gaye, haar gaye. Kuch samay ke liye beshak, vaapis uth jana. 2 minute ke liye thak ke baith gaye. Us moment mein jo aapko shanti feel hui, That is the shining of your true being.
So, if I say there are some transactions that are good, like for example, a transaction is good if I get what I want and the thing that I've given is not as much of a big deal, I would say that is a good transaction. What if I find a person, any person, not just marriage, in which what I'm giving, I feel like it comes very easily to me, so I don't think it's a big deal, but the one who's receiving it, he feels that it's a big thing. And maybe both of these people are wired in that way, where what they give to the other person is small for them, but the person who's receiving thinks it's a big deal. So won't it mean that these people will be eternally happy with each other because their efforts of giving are not as much as the joy when they're receiving? They don't feel a burden when they give. What would you say?
I would say experiment it out. Bina experiment ke maza nahi aayega. I would say instead of just, you know, making it an imagination and trying to contemplate and decipher and extrapolate from there, I would say try it out. Yeah. And there are possibilities in our life where we can try this out. Because without trying it out, it will just remain a theory. So it's very, very important to try this out.
Yeah.
Okay, so I think Anusha has shared something which I did not notice. Anusha, I'll just read it out. When we are treated as if we don't exist by the same people who once valued in some manner, beautiful. And when this becomes a life pattern, we start feeling we don't belong or that we don't matter. How do we convince ourselves that we are still enough and can be happy? So Anusha, that is a beautiful question. Why? Because this is what happens in our relationships. This is what we call falling in love. Somebody begins to appreciate us beautifully. Somebody begins to value us so much. And our sense of worth, since we are operating from the sense of lack all the time, not knowing who we truly are, we are operating from the ego self, which is a separate self, which is a very limited, constricted self, and always feels this sense of lack. So when I enter into a relationship through this sense of lack, which may not be true for every relationship, actually, because there are relationships where people have not connected ki tu mujhko pura kar, main tujhe pura karunga. Yeah. So as if there are two worlds apart and yet living together. These are also relationships. Khalil Gibran also talks about, you know, such relationships. So mostly our relationships start from this sense of lack. We are waiting for attention. We are waiting for approval. And here comes someone who is, I am the world for that someone. I'm just the center of attraction for that someone. That is what happens in the beginning of a relationship. Now, whatever value I get through that person, that gets kind of as if, since there was this sense of lack from which I was operating, I feel very contented with this topping up. As if somebody is topping up. Yeah, tu to great, you know, you're so beautiful, so intelligent. You know, you make my world spin, all these things. These are just stupidities, but aur bhi details mein baat hoti hai na, jab starting mein jo hota hai, aur bhi detail mein baat hoti hai. You feel so fulfilled with the other person. So what actually is happening is, we were waiting for this fulfillment. What we begin to think is that, I am getting this fulfillment from this other person. And that is why we crave for such relationships. Because there is a drop of love. I'm not saying that it's all emotional mixture. There is a drop of love also there. You share oneness with each other. Yeah. So, yes, Saurabh, I'll come to that in some time. So when I am operating from this sense of lack, waiting for someone to approve of me, to validate me, here comes someone who approves of me, validates me, and makes me worth it. my sense of self gets aggravated because of that person, I feel happy. I feel fulfilled. I want to meet that person again and again so that I feel more happier. Yeah. Now that person changes over time. People change. Now you are not anymore the sense of center of attraction for that person. It brings suffering. And then we begin to wonder what is wrong with me or what is wrong with the other person, because the sense of lack comes back again. Since the start of the relationship was the sense of lack. Yeah. So how can we be happy? There is only one path to lasting happiness. Anusha, there may be many, many ways through which we can reach it. That is different. You know, truth is a pathless land. You can arrive at many, through many, many different ways. But without knowing our true nature, we will never ever be lastingly happy. There, we cannot avoid knowing our true nature. If not in this lifetime, another. So if now we are sure that I have suffered enough, I have ran enough after people and situations to give me happiness, am I ready to take the responsibility in my hands? Am I ready to notice even logically, statistically, that running after things and people has not been able to give me lasting contentment and happiness? Can we admit it for ourselves? Once we admit it, we become receptive. Otherwise, we are in our arrogance. I know, I know. Once we know that our attempts have failed, we become receptive to grace. This connects me to what Saurabh is asking. Being observer versus surrender to God, are these two same? Yes. They are same. Because when you are stationed knowingly in your awareness, you are not wanting anything. You are content, relaxed. This is what we call surrender to God. But the next moment the ego rises up, the mind comes up with the story part again, and the surrender is gone. Again, a new demand, again, a new expectation. And that is why we say surrender is a continuing process. The moment a new demand arises, you offer it to the world, to the divine. You say, I see that rising up. And why they rise again and again? Because they are very old sanskaras, old tendencies. They will rise up again and again. But what I will do is, I will not give them as much importance as I give them today. Yes, demands are there. Yes, expectations are there. But that is not who I truly am. Yeah, so this is what Kabir would mean when he would say, Kabir kutta Ram ka, motiyan mera Ram naam. You know, he refers that I am so loyal to God. And God means this, our true essence, our true being. I am so loyal to it that I am just tied up with my Lord. While we are not loyal, we are not born loyal. We have to slowly, slowly, slowly. That is the journey. Somehow that is the human journey. That we are born as a slave to, not in the infancy, but later on as we get conditioned, we become a slave to our desires, ambitions, greed, since we work from this sense of lack. Slowly, 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 through all these our journeys, full of struggle and suffering, slowly we arrive at our own self. It's almost an irony that we arrive at our own self. We were always our own self, but yet it's a journey, they say. And we see that I actually don't need anything to be contented. And that is what we call surrender. Saying yes to all that is. Saying yes to the resistances, saying yes to everything that is there, but not becoming their slave. So all the expectations may rise up, go down, rise up, go down. Ambitions, greed may come up, rise up, go down. But I am not a slave. Now, having said that, it does not mean that you become lifeless. Because people speculate, you know, that, oh my God, I will become lifeless if there are no desires. There are true desires also which arise out of compassion. For example, if somebody is hitting a dog, you know, and I'm crossing a street, then I have a desire to save that, protect that dog. This desire is not arising from the sense of lack. This desire is arising from our compassion. So slowly we begin to work for those desires who come out of compassion and inherent sense of completion within. You know, when I am one with that, the whole universe, when I am one with that, would I allow somebody to be beaten? Somebody innocent should to be beaten? Would I allow it? Yeah. So that is a different kind of a desire which must be followed. So slowly we also kind of begin to differentiate between a desire arising from the sense of lack and a desire arising from our true being. Yes, Abhishek.
As I was thinking, I was like, we focus too much on happiness. But I'm curious, like, should we seek happiness? Is happiness the end-all, be-all? You know, because I was just thinking in terms like when someone is saying, right, stories like someone ignored me and they just went past, or, you know, some person was showing you affection and they stopped. In all of these stories, I see that we are just looking at the story from our own view, right? Maybe something similar happens to other people. Why can't, if this person is ignoring, we go up and say hi ourselves? If someone who used to show us affection once upon a time and has stopped, why can't we initiate, right? Because in the first sense, they showed you affection when, you know, you were just there and you were happy when they validated you. Why can't, you know, when they are not validating you anymore, you can go back and validate them? Like, or in the example of the dog, we are showing compassion to the dog. So it's like, you know, maybe this is not about us. Maybe it's not about you. And if you see things that way, it would mean surrendering your happiness, right? When you are showing, when you're validating someone, maybe you're validating 100 people and maybe none of them, let's just say, unfortunately, none of them validate you. But, you know, maybe what if you find happiness in that? And then again, the question comes, you know, again, I'm finding happiness in validating other people or taking care of other people or being compassionate towards other people makes me happy. That makes me question why happiness is such a crucial element, and should we really consider it as the center point of our universe? And since all of us are technically, you know, not technically, but we are all copies of each other, happiness seems like the center of the entire universe. Since we are the ones who occupy it, shouldn't we try to question if it truly is the center, or if there is something else we should could be the center? Like, how do we reflect on this? Yeah,
beautiful. Yes. So we must question. We must question, because in finding happiness, in seeking for happiness and through external means, we hurt, abuse, and we do all kind of things where we think that it is giving me happiness, so it's okay for me to do that. But you are actually making the other person more dependent on you. So we must question it. I think that is one part of your question. The other part is, I think all of us would definitely agree, we are at these stages in our life. The purpose of this life is not happiness. Happiness is my true nature. I have to realize that I cannot get it from anywhere. Lasting happiness we are talking of. Fulfillment, contentment that we seek through validation from others. all this fulfillment, contentment, peace, happiness, that is my true nature. So slowly we arrive there. The purpose of my life is not to seek happiness. The purpose of life is growth of consciousness. That is what happens over years with us. We grow in consciousness. We grow kinder. We grow more compassionate if we have actually used our life. You know, if we have not really used our life to grow in consciousness, then these things won't happen. Like, we need effort there. Those of us who are ready to put in effort and make every challenge as a means to growth in consciousness, as a means to recognize your own uglinesses, your own weaknesses, and to transform them. That is what we mean by growth of consciousness. Bahar kuch nahi milega. Hamare andar hi pura universe hai. To apne andar humne inward turn karke nazar andar karni hai, what we call the third eye of the Shiva. It sees beyond the face values. So we also have a third eye, the inner vision. It sees beyond the face values. So external happening may have happened. What is the learning for me here? How do I become a better person through this? So the purpose of life, I think, first of all, the thing is that we must question it, that is it really happiness? And then we know slowly through our own experiences, if we are maybe in this lifetime, another lifetime, doesn't matter, that my true nature is this peace and happiness, which cannot be given from anywhere. Yeah. And then there is also a further journey. The further journey is transformation of my earthly life through that knowing. Kyunki aisa nahi ho sakta ki that I know who I truly am, yet my behavior is bad. I know who I truly am, and yet whatever I say and do is very abusive. It means that there is nothing that is really truly happened. Yeah. So that is what we struggle with mostly. That in our meditative experiences, we experience bliss. But the moment we interact with somebody outside, we again, the same tendencies kick in. The same pattern of behavior, the same rage, anger kicks in, because it takes time for the, you know, older patterns to dissolve off or fade off. So this is the journey, I would say, if you talk about the further purpose, you know, that what are we actually trying to do with all these life experiences? The purpose is growing in our consciousness, becoming a better and better, kinder, softer, compassionate human being. Why kinder, compassionate? Because that is who we truly are. Whenever we are abusive, we hurt our own self and we hurt the other. Yeah. So abuse is not my true nature. I can never be restful when I am abusive. And that is why if a person is abusive to you, the first harm has been done to himself. Not only to you, he has actually done abuse over onto himself. Yeah. Yes, Abhishek, you were going to ask something.
So one thing I was going to ask is, you said the growth of consciousness, right? So I was thinking, what is the nature of this growth? Like, what would you say growth? And then when you said transformation, my question was like, what are we hoping to transform into?
Yeah. So, I would not go into transformation, because that would be a whole series, transformation of nature, but I'll just point at it. So our true nature is this awareness. And then we have instruments. We have instruments of mind. We have instruments of feelings. We have instrument of the body. These are our instruments. Now, it doesn't make any sense if I know who I truly am, yet the mind is corrupted, the feelings are corrupted, and the body is also corrupted. So what I mean by transformation is that the mind, the feelings, and the body get transformed, changed in the light of knowing who you truly are. So I'll just touch upon this much for that part. What was the other part that you were asking? Apart from transformation, growth of consciousness. Yeah.
Yes.
So you would see, Abhishek, how old are you?
27.
So have you seen yourself change, evolve, grow in your journey?
A lot in last 5 years.
Absolutely. Yeah. So that is what we mean by growth in consciousness. पकना कहते हैं ना, जैसे घड़ा पक जाता है, slowly, slowly, ripens, maturity, ripening. And the amazing thing is that the more, if we are truly ripening beautifully, the more childlike we become. No, because there comes a phase in our life that we are so serious about everything, you know, this has to be done, dogmatic, ritualistic, you know, okay, this is the way it should be. So those are the phases also that we go through, very limited, you know, strict phases. And then
I actually had a point earlier when Ashok ji was sharing his experience, right, where I had the question of this age and how you said the ripening. So, I mean, this is like a very subjective question maybe for both of you. Like, what do you think is the age where this kind of things happen mostly, right? Because we said like some journey you need to go through to find out that that is not. And, you know, when you give up, maybe you find the happiness. So what age, if you have to put a number on it, would you say?
There is no age, Abhishek. There is no no age at all. For example, you know,
are we saying an 18-year-old can reach that stage?
See, we are that. There is no reading required. So, for example, I have kids, and my kids are 8 and 6 and a half. Yeah, and they have a knowing of who they truly are.
But they don't have the experiences of. I'm assuming since they are in home. They have as much bad experiences as someone who's very grown up and has
absolutely not. They, as they grow up, they will also go through all those experiences, what they have to. One cannot avoid them, one must not avoid them.
So we can't say they have reached the transformed stage. That's not possible.
Transformation is centuries,
but we are not gonna live that long.
Yeah, so we only if we consider ourselves as the body.
Okay.
Yeah? Only if I know myself as the body, that okay, I have only 50 years to live and this much is the time for transformation. But in eternity, there is enough time. In eternity, there is timelessness. So the universe is not in a hurry. Why are we in a hurry? Because we suffer.
We are in a hurry because we are dying, right?
We are dying, the body is dying.
Yeah.
But the process of transformation takes ages and years. The true transformation. And if you want to know more, read Mother and Sri Aurobindo. That is what their yoga is all about. They call it integral yoga. Huh? So they talk about integral yoga, which means that first you know yourself, who you truly are. Get stationed there. Yeah. Now, you have a mastery over your mind, your feelings, your body, and which slowly over years, centuries, or whatever time it may take, will transform in that divine knowing. Yeah, so it's really a long, long process. If you talk about transformation of the whole nature, and if you really are interested, I would invite you, go ahead and discover. We have many circles also happening on the words of Mother Sri Aurobindo. You can do it yourself, you know, Google, everything is available. So search there are a few sites also where works of Mother and Sri Aurobindo are available. What they talk about, a transformation of nature.
What is the keyword I'm looking for in this?
You can type integral yoga. And I can actually share a few sites with you. That would be nice. So I would WhatsApp you a few sites on which you can look up their works and what they have talked about.
Yeah.
And Mother and Sri Aurobindo say that nirvana or liberation from the separate self, the sense of this lack that we live by, it is not the last step of this earthly life. It is the first step of integral yoga. because the moment I begin to know myself as who I truly am, you know, knowingly, consciously, then only in light of that knowing, I can actually embark on the path of integral yoga. ना इंटेग्रल योगा मीनिंग वही जो अभिषेक बात कर रहा था ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन ऑफ द माइंड नाउ इफ वी लुक एट द माइंड टुडे दैट वी हैव यू विल नो व्हाट ऑल देयर इज इन द माइंड यू वी ऑल नो अवर कंटेंट्स ऑफ द माइंड व्हाट ऑल वी कीप देयर नाउ इज दिस अ रिफाइंड माइंड इज दिस अ डिवाइन माइंड सर्टेनली नॉट वी ऑल नो दैट अवर फीलिंग्स आर फुल ऑफ जेलसी हेट कॉम्पिटिशन अब्यूज You know, hitting each other, making my ego superior over your ego. So are they divine, refined feelings? No. But the more and more I get stationed in my true essence, now I can have a mastery over the instruments, which is the mind, the thoughts. I can keep the temple clean now because I know that that is not worth it. That is not where I want to be. So one can keep the mind clean, one can keep the feelings clean, and also, the physical body more supple and agile. And even there in the physical body, so much of work to be done, making the body more conscious. So it's as if you touch Mother and Sri Aurobindo and you touch an infinite ocean that is there in front of you. And you would not be unemployed in this life. You know, you would have enough things to work upon, such as the beauty of, these words.
By the way, when we are mentioning body, are we talking about exercising?
Not only exercise. So Mother also talks about the cells of the body, how they have as if lost the faith in the divine. And that has to be rekindled. So to the level of the cells. And there is collective fear in our cells. There is collective anxiety, collective anger in our cells. So slowly that also gets released. And again, not a matter of one session, two session, or one lifetime, just a journey on which one can embark. And one feels that it's so beautiful a journey. Kyunki sara inner work hai na? It's independent of you wanting happiness from others. It's totally as if the microscope has turned inside and you have so much to do here. पहले सारा ध्यान बाहर था अब सारा ध्यान अंदर चला गया है और अब दिख रहा है पहले जो नहीं दिखता था अब वो दिखता है कबीर वन ऑफ द कपलेट्स ही सेज हृदय माही आरसी और मुख देखा नहीं जाए मुख तो तभी देखिए जब दिल की दुविधा जाए सो ही सेज दैट देयर इज अ मिरर इन माय हार्ट बट आई एम नॉट एबल टू सी माय ट्रू सेल्फ इन दैट मिरर हाउ वुड आई लुक एट माय ट्रू सेल्फ मुख तो तभी देखिए जब दिल की दुविधा जाए All this turmoil of our mind and feelings, all the complex distortion that we have, when that clears off, even for a moment, I see my true self. Not by these eyes, I know, I sense, I practically feel for myself that peace, that calm, that contentment. And as long as the dil ki duvidha is there, that as if it serves as a dark cloud over a blue sky. So I'm not able to see my true nature owing to those dark clouds. So again, a lot of purification, a lot of work to be done if we really want to. Beautiful work actually makes life worth it. Yeah. Yeah, so any last comments, anyone, people who have not shared much, if you have anything you want to share at this moment. Okay, so I'm assuming there is nothing at the moment. So I thank you everyone for joining. And yeah, thanks Abhishek. Thank you everyone for questioning, doubting, sharing. I think very few people shared today, but thank you for listening also. Those of you who were patiently listening. And more power to all of you. And yeah, May grace guide us all. Yeah, thank you. Thanks, everyone.
Thanks, Monica.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.